took some time, but they're here. I will present the results of the case study I developed together with Jochen. And the idea is that you can use it also for discussing the challenges and the limitations encountered in doing this case study. So I will do the presentation and he's saying the questions in the end, and then we can have a discussion. The title is Risk-Based Design of an Offshore Wind Turbine Support and Structure using Polygon Information Analysis. So as opposed to most case studies in this cost action, the focus here is to use site-specific information to inform decisions for design rather than for operation and maintenance. So this is the agenda we'll cover. I will start by talking about the decision scenario. Then I will introduce the methods used, talk about a little of the results, and then the I will mention the challenges and the limitations. The case study focuses on one specific point of the design of an offshore support structure for wind energy. This point, calling the NVGL guideline, the frequency check, and it's usually covered as kind of avoiding a hazard, which is the resonance with the installation frequencies caused by the late passing and the rotary passing frequency. And the frequency check in guidelines is quite simple. So if you focus on a deterministic regulation framework, the idea is that the expected natural frequency, we assume there is some uncertainty, and this is covered by assuming there can be a plus minus 5% variability in the computation, and then we need to leave additional 5% to the excitation. And this doesn't focus on the consequences of the resonance hazard. It focuses on avoiding the resonance hazard, which is fine in theory, but there has been cases in which already operating wind farms have encountered these dynamic amplifications, and the consequences are usually that either the structure needs to be inspected differently than it was planned at the beginning, or the operational regime needs to be changed during the operational life. So it has consequences associated. There's a paper in which is co-author, in which an offshore wind farm in the German North Sea has been monitored since 2007. It was this 5 gigawatt turbine, and they found that in the monitoring system, they found the Sommerfeld effect, is this dynamic amplification due to the rotor passing frequencies was present, and the damage that the structure was facing was higher than it was estimated in the design. And the consequence was that the operational regime had to be changed. And of course, the objective of an offshore wind turbine is not to be very standing, it's to reduce energy, so modifying the operational regime has losses. So the idea is to treat the hazard of dynamic amplifications using a probabilistic framework, risk-based decision framework more specifically, to quantify what are the consequences of having a certain design with a certain first natural frequency, design first natural frequency in a certain position, what are the consequences, and how the site-specific information of the soil be quantified in our design decisions. This is just to illustrate for those who are not that familiar with offshore wind. This left figure is the relation between the rotor speeds of blades passing a certain RPM can be related depending on the control of the turbine with the wind speeds. So for a certain rotor speed, there is for a certain wind speed, there is a certain rotor speed. And here, when it's constant, it means it's reached the rated rotor speed due to having faced a wind speed larger than rated wind speed. So if you can expect these are large winds, let's say 15 meters per second, but these are not unlikely situation. Actually, we want the turbine to perform there. And especially in winter, if you look at how many times the rotor is rotating at this RPM, in winter it's very often. So this means that we are in this line here, which is kind of the one that would produce more dynamic implications if the design tends to be more to the left. We are here, part of it. So the idea is that one of the constraints of design, it needs to be designed in this region, which is called soft stitch, due to economical reasons, to avoid resonance. But we have uncertainty in how we estimate the tensile frequency. The uncertainty can be overcome mainly in two ways. One is to invest in design classes or a more steep design that will move the natural frequency further to the right. Another strategy would be to acquire further information, have a better picture of how soil structure interaction is, and by that, managing or treating the uncertainty. And we can expect, of course, that the optimal decision, if you consider these two, would be a trade between it. In the workshop in Amsterdam, I presented this influence diagram as the first attempt to cover most of the parameters that are present in our decision scenario. Of course, when I started putting numbers and we started calculating this was whether feasible to be treated. And I ended up with this influence error, which was kind of the most simplistic that would still preserve the basics of the problem. So the main idea is that we need to relate the hazard to the dynamic implications to something that can be associated with some losses. That something is structural failure, fatigue. Dynamic implications yield a larger fatigue damage and therefore higher probability of failure due to fatigue. And that failure can relate to losses. So we have here our basic variable, random variable, which is the soil speed. This first attempt at this case diving, we are just focusing on holding the soil by its soil velocity. And here we have the decision about what is the best design we can produce with the available information. The design is related to a certain cost, and here I estimated proportional to volume of steel. That is, of course, not the case, but the first attempt. Seems logical at least that it would be proportional to it. The soil stiffness, we start by having non-specific or non-site specific information, so we can think that there have been tests performed by a certain company that we can acquire that has tested in that area, and based on those data we can have a picture of how the soil in that particular region can be. So you will have large uncertainty associated, that would give us prior information. And then we can of course perform further tests in the specific points where the turbine would be installed. And this is over here in the test decision. And if we decide to test, we will have some outcomes. Performing those tests also cost associated. So depending on the uncertainty that we have on the soil, and depending on which design we decide to perform, we will have certain probability of failure associated. And that will let us calculate the expected utility for each design. Now I will talk about the model. So the idea was to prepare a model that was as simple as possible, so I could it could be manageable in a probabilistic framework. And sometimes when you try to make things as easy as possible, you end up having to work more, you be more strict, because you need to program yourself the certifications. So I decided to run a few models in MATLAB, in which I could model the dynamic behavior of the structure, but due to some nonlinearities, you need to run simulations in the time domain, and you need to solve equation on motion. So the simplification here is I will use only the first mode of migration to represent the dynamic behavior of the structure. And I kept the decisions to the minimum, and I kept, I proposed 12 designs based on two design or two decision parameters, which are these two, the diameter and the thickness at a certain height. And I assume that the transition between that cell diameter and thickness to this reference diameter and thickness would be linear, and that's from then only would be constant. So I try to keep these decisions to the minimum. And these are the 12 designs that I consider in the decision mode. So I can map the relation between the first natural frequency and the soil modulus and elasticity, and as we see, the relation is complex. And this has also an important first outcome, and that is that due to the Jensen's inequality, the expected value of the natural frequency would be always smaller or equal than the natural frequency computed at expected soil properties. This means that if you look at the deterministic relations, we are actually moving further to the excitation regions, which is exactly the opposite we want to see in a conservative design. So these are the two excitation regions, and this is our design space. Here is assuming this is our prior knowledge, and based on this relation here, we can map also the prior estimation of the first natural frequency. I consider these 11 fatigue design models based on the A13 shallow side of the WP4 keyboard, which lamp states are considered based on the average 10 minutes wind speed, associated turbulence intensity, significant wave height, and peak periods. and the quality of those particular cases to occur are determined by the distribution. In order to simplify the dynamic calculations, I integrated the rotational sampling of the rotor excitations into the wind spectrum. Therefore, I avoided to perform parallastic simulations, which are usually done for these calculations in engineering courses. So these are the spectrums I used as environmental loading. And these are the equations I used for the dynamic model that I already modeled. So here, the simplification is that I used the generalized mass stiffness and damping base on using the first natural, the first mode of preparation in the equations. And this is how I calculated the damage, assuming that the fatigue or the lifetime of the service life and the structure is 20 years. So I run 1 hour simulations. I have 11 fatigue load cases. I produce grade stations around 50 of the soil for each. I compute the natural frequency, the fatigue like damage, and this is the mapping between the fatigue like damage and the first natural. For each of the 12 designs. So we see that at this point, the fatigue like damage is the highest for all designs. This is expected, that this natural frequency will be matching exactly the boundary or the end boundary of the 1P region, in which the not only the rotor rotates at that particular frequency frequent manner, but also in environmental loading it's the worst case scenario. And having this mapping done, I can calculate based on the probabilistic prior definition of the soil modus of elasticity and also the first natural frequency, expected fatigue like damage and probability. This is calculated using this instant function, which is taken from the JCSS probabilistic model. The definition of fatigue failure is also used considered as a random variable that is not normally distributed. Has some set, has mean value equal to 1. And some scattered in deterministic science, the definition of fatigue damage based on other minor rules is going to be equal to 1. So, based on prior knowledge, I'm calculating the probability of failure, I can calculate expected mutation. And this gives us a first attempt of seeing based on this. Telling the mitigation hazard what would be the best design given our constraints. But now we are trying to model how to quantify the value of site specific soil information. And for that, given that this type of testing is equality information, to test we get estimation of the modus of elasticity. And this needs to be related to the true state of nature. So the best way to do that is with the likelihood function. This here is not done based on data. Again, but for offshore inference, it's quite difficult when we're in this space in which we're trying to acquire that data. But for now, this is estimated. And based on these estimations, we can create our likelihood function. In GIMI, for the modeling in anticipation, framework, is linked to discretize this likelihood function. And we need to compute the sphere distribution for each considered outcome of the test. So this is an example of three sphere distributions. So this is our prior knowledge. And based on this likelihood function, we obtain these sphere distributions given a certain outcome. This is already, in my opinion, an important thing to consider. If you don't model the prior information, when you acquire information, you don't have a way to quantify that value if you don't have the likelihood. So even if you're not actively calculating the value of information, doing this provides you some further knowledge because it lets you map between prior and posterior and give you already information about the quality of the testing technique you're using. So basically, this is our result of this utility for prior information. You can do the same for the different outcomes of the test between patient inference, and we obtain that these are the posterior optimum in the green cells, the posterior optimum speculative utility for each test outcome. And we see, of course, it's expected that depending on the test outcome, it will trigger different optimum decisions. If soil is very bad, it needs the most strong sign, a stiffer one. If the test gives the soil is very good, we don't need that much. So we can see already that information can trigger different decisions, and that its value is strictly linked to the decisions that might be triggered by that. So this is the presentation. I just want to point out, I guess, that the main challenge I found that once you start combining probabilistic methodologies with FFE models, the computational times start to go up, and you start losing some of the probabilistic or correct probabilistic modeling because you can just not have that much time. Also, that the development of the likelihood function is probably the most challenging parts in the value of information analysis. And if you have any questions, please ask.
So, one question. When you compute the posterior,
you compute the posterior for soil stiffness. Okay, what are the measurements? What is the model that collects measurements in soil stiffness? This is one question. The second question is that even if you compute soil stiffness, okay, that stiffness is a question whether it's appropriate or not for different speeds of the model, you know. But this is a detail that, you know, the framework might have.
This should be reflected in the likelihood function somehow. And since we are not using data at this point of the study yet, it's difficult to answer because we are not there. But additional to that, of course, there is also there's going to be rheological aspects in the how the soil behaves, so due to dynamic or cyclic behavior of the structure, the soil will stop to be more sticky. It's difficult to predict that in the design section. And it will discover, there will be a lot of aspects that maybe at the beginning of the life of the structure, there is not any identification that can happen for every time. So the idea is to try to reflect all that in the holistic vision. So the reality is that that is, of course, not easy. Are there answers, please?
I would like to start showing, from my understanding, the example case study. So you are dealing with a new structure. The structure is not installed yet. Is it one structure or is it a group of structures in the same field where the same soil is applied? Because we are going to install many of these. The soil, are you dealing with a group of structures or with one structure? How do you think? Yes, maybe you can help me to answer. If you are dealing with several or one?
At this time, I am with one, and the idea is to extend it to with one.
Then, your performance indicator is the fatigue lifetime, is that correct?
Yes.
And your measurement is the stiffness of the soil. Or
yes.
Even not, you visit. And your parameter is the frequency of the structure, I think. Is that correct? Yes. And now your limit state. Your limit state is the fatigue line minus 30 years, or what is your limit state? For calculating probability of failure.
Probability of failure is fatigue damage minus damage resistance.
One question or question comment which helder we like. What are your costs? For example, how much does it cost for taking this, let's say, this monitoring of the soil? And what are the failure costs? If failure happens, particularly, how do you, what cost do you implement during this? And so, if the analysis are cost uncertain or?
So uncertainty in the cost is something not that easy to implement in a framework like this. You can see that if you put uncertainty around cost, when you have the speculativity, you're not using the main model. So that is not the correct way to sort of uncertainty in the cost. Here, I'm just assuming some values, so the cost of construction is proportional to the volume of steel. Cost of failure is proportional to the construction costs. So far, it's just grouped stations.
And for the cost gap, for example,
of course, you have expected validity, but one can do, let's say, some sensitivity analysis, see what would be in that case. Because one main problem is the cost. Elder was pointing out correctly, you have problems with the cost. We have a lot of models, but we got some peak failure, crack growth, and so on. But as, for example, we have loss of production of energy when this fails, and so on. Therefore, I ask, it's just, let's say, for how to deal it in standards. Therefore, I ask that not with respect to your analysis.
Yeah.
And your example is for my understanding. How would you deal with uncertainty and cost in general? What would you recommend?
So, costs that are going to be the same no matter the design. We'll just shift the cost up and down. So the cost of shutdown will be the same whether it's there either 6 or 7, because the turbine is the same. So this will be a shift and will not change the output. Cost directed, the cost of failure, some of them will be associated with the choice of design, and how that number is reflected, as you say, to make guesses and see how sensitive your decision is to that estimation. So in this case, I saw that the estimation, very sense of the cost of failure is proportional to the construction costs, and that's proportionality constant magnified in some reasonable value. It's the optimal decision doesn't change that much. So we don't have to be that precise in my opinion, assessing some of the costs, and many of the costs are the same independent on its, the decision. And that is the case for design. All the costs are very sensitive. And for example, I was thinking how at the beginning of when I was building this example, how do I need to consider the cost of secondary steel, bolt landing, or head for. They're literally the same, no matter the design issues. So that will not affect my design. So,
yeah. So this is for me an interesting statement. If you, in the conclusions, you say what are the, in the conclusions, if one wants to structure the examples, what are the important parameters, and so on, and what will affect your decision, I think this would be, in the conclusion, an interesting moment.
I think here this is an example. I'll give you an unrelated comment to the whole book. Because this is a particular example where you see what is the value of monitoring. You try to design it, you try to update your software, you know nothing about, you know, if what you did, your model was good or wrong, or it depends on the speed, whatever. So when you monitor the structure, so you place things and you monitor the structure, you will get a better model using the results about the soil status, and probably come back to the soil model, you know, that, and find a better relation between soil stiffness and measurement, okay, to build a better ranking. So what is missing, I think, is that we don't monitor several structures, so we don't get a lot of information. By monitoring, you get information to do a better model, okay? And you apply the framework, so you can apply. So you have the framework that you presented, it applies, but it's so accurate as, you know, depends, factors, depends on the modeling, the information that you have in specific, you know, the subcomponents, like the soil.
Just as from experience, but if I take costly, do some costly analysis, I might have another one. So it is interesting.
Yeah. Maybe a more general comment that if we had measurements from different structures, okay, we learn a lot.
Yeah.
And we can use them for future structures, how to design them, how to, you know, to use this information in this framework.
So, exactly, so you mean this information is just for the one structure?
Because this is just for the one structure, okay, but
understand.
If we had all this data, it's more helpful. Okay, we don't have data. Just have some data.
We structure our standards in three categories. New structure, existing structure, but always one, or a group of structures, as we said. But you don't inspect all of them, it's too expensive. For example, offshore structure. You inspect 2, 3, 4. You understand?
Yeah.
So you have to select, which is a procedure and then answer.
Yeah, but I like this